What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Our entire aim in unit testing is to be able to test pieces of code in isolation. We're not writing tests that use the full application, but rather trying to end up with hundreds, even thousands, of separate unit tests, each one testing a single small part of the system independently of the others. Now, if the class or the component or the current unit under test is made of totally self-contained behaviors, it's quite straightforward to create unit tests for it. You can directly create new tests for its method without caring what any of the other classes do. But let's face it, most, if not all of the time, these classes will need to interact with one another. They will need to interact with databases, with websites, with the file system. And some of these things are slow, some require a connection, some are unreliable. And if we're trying to do test-driven development and build our tests alongside building our application, some of these objects may not even exist yet, they just haven't been written. So, say we write a test that instantiates multiple objects of different types, loads information from the web, saves to a database, writes to the file system, and then we make an assertion, and that assertion fails. We won't know where to look, because we've introduced multiple points of failure. Our so-called unit test is now testing much more than just this unit. So, how do we solve this? Well, while testing that particular unit, we need something that allows us to assume that every other part of the application is perfect and reliable, so we can focus our test purely on the current unit. And if a problem occurs, we know exactly where that problem is. One technique that allows us to do that is mock objects. We replace the usage of other objects, other systems, or external dependencies with fake or mock implementations that will repeatedly behave the way we expect them to. So, instead of passing a query to a real database, we pass a query to a mock version that's just code. It's just in memory and will reliably return the results we want our unit to work on. We can even replace a call to an object that doesn't exist yet with a call to a mock version of that object that behaves exactly as the real one is supposed to. So there's a few classic reasons to look at mock objects. The first being that the real object hasn't been written yet. After that, it's if what we're calling needs a UI or a human intervention. Well, we can't wait for somebody to interact with our external system if we want to run our unit test 100 times a day. So we emulate what that person is supposed to input. Next, if that system is slow or difficult to set up, one of the most common reasons for using mock objects is if you are interacting with some external resource like a file system or a database. Say we're saving things to a database and we're doing that 100 times a day. If we were to call the real database, we'll end up changing the actual state of that database. And we don't want to do that, of course. Again, we're focusing on the current unit. We might be interested at a later point to test that the database is working as expected, but when we're testing another unit, we want to take that as a given. So, what does mocking look like in a test, in code? Say I wanted to test my current unit, which calls one of Facebook's APIs to retrieve a couple profile details and posts, and then uses the returned information to do some stuff. Well, this could be non-deterministic, as we're not sure what it's going to return, and sometimes it may unexpectedly throw network errors. So, we want to take it as a fact that this Facebook API will just work and will return these results, allowing us to work on them and assert some behavior after they are retrieved. To do that, here we can create a new class called Mock Facebook Service that extends our initial service. Then we can instantiate that object and write its class so it returns a repeatable, prearranged response from this getProfiles method. Then we can go ahead and use it as if we were using the real service, but this way we always get a reliable response. We don't have to worry about network connections or anything else. Again, an important but subtle distinction. In this test, we are not interested in testing the actual Facebook service. It is a given. We want to use the results it returns for our actual assertions. Okay, now there are two things we often do with mock objects. We want them to return expected values and do it quickly and repeatedly, similarly to what we just demonstrated, but we also want to use them to verify that the way we are calling these objects is correct. That if we are going to call a web service, we are positive that we're going to pass the right data into that service. One way of doing this is by adding a method to the mock object class and tell it to expect a certain value. So we could tell it you're going to expect this profile ID, for example. Then later on in the test, when we call the getProfile method, we could verify that this is actually the case. And by calling this getProfile method, my mock object itself can assert that what was passed in was correct, and fails if it wasn't, alerting us that perhaps the initial state of our data in this unit isn't what we thought it was. Now, there's a couple of terms that you'll hear when you start talking about mock objects. One is the distinction between fakes, mocks, and stubs. Let's tackle this next. A fake object is an object that behaves, quote-unquote, naturally, but is not, quote-unquote, real. Fakes have a pre-written implementation of the object that they are supposed to represent. They have the same method signatures that return pre-arranged, pre-written responses. The purpose of a fake is not to affect the behavior of the system under test, but rather to simplify the implementation of the test by removing unnecessary or heavy dependencies. An example of a fake could be a database class. So, instead of going to the DB and retrieving a certain entity by ID, we could have a map populated at the beginning of the test that returns the desired objects for us by key. The action performed is still behaving naturally. We are taking in an ID, searching in a bunch of objects, and returning with one specific entity, but the difference is that the data we are working with is fake, making the operation faster, more concise, and accurate for our unit tests. Now, a stub is an implementation that behaves, quote-unquote, unnaturally. It is pre-configured to respond to specific inputs with specific outputs. The purpose of a stub is to get your unit under test into a specific state. For example, if we are writing a test for some code that interacts with a certain API, we could stub that API with another that always returns the same response. This way we can write tests that make assertions about how the system reacts to that particular state. Our original call is not meant to return the same result over and over again, regardless of the input as we did here. Hence, by modifying its normal behavior, we created a stub. Mocks, on the other hand, are similar to stubs but with verification added in, as we saw earlier. The purpose of a mock is to make assertions about how the unit under test interacted with the dependency. For example, if we were writing a test for a system that uploads files to a website, we could build a mock that accepts a file and asserts that the given file was correct. It isn't going to actually upload that file just like stubs, but it will return with the desired results only if the assertions pass. Finally, fakes, stubs, and mocks all belong to what we call test doubles. A test double is any object used in a test. It is any system that contributes in testing our unit. Some other kinds of test doubles include dummy values or spies. Okay, just like we have unit testing frameworks, there are several mock frameworks that we can use to help in the mocking process. These aren't part of the testing frameworks we've been using like JUnit, they're actually different. The benefit is that they provide some structure. They can make it easier for you to define your mock objects, and depending on the framework that you would use, they may sometimes remove the need to create an explicit custom class. There are several different available mock object frameworks, and these aren't as identical as the general XUnit frameworks, so they are worth taking a look at independently to see what they offer your particular project. Java has several popular mocking frameworks that include JMock, EasyMock, and Mockito. Mockito is a little different from the others as it allows you to dynamically generate your mock objects rather than explicitly writing classes for them. We will soon be covering Mockito on Geekific and everything you need to know about that framework, so stay tuned for that. Just bear in mind that these frameworks introduce some level of risk, like if you're happily using a mock object because the real one wasn't written yet, and it is then written with different behavior than you expected, you're going to run into problems. But they are definitely a tool to make use of while unit testing. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.